Hello, brothers and sisters. Instead of making a really long video, because I had so much information I wanted to put out, that I thought I'd just make it in two parts. And it kind of made sense, because the first video was more about the negative stuff, mostly, that's been going on and why I think it's going on. But this video, I will continue with a few of the dreams and visions that were positive. And if you guys can remember, one time the Lord had told me, he said, "Angel, get in your prayer closet." And starting at that day, my dreams and visions went from, let's say, 90% good to 10% bad. When he told me, "Angel, get in your prayer closet," they went from like to 90% bad, you know, 10% good. Like, they kind of just have been at a trickle since that time period. And, you know, I think he does that to keep me going, to keep me learning, and, you know, line upon line, precept upon precept, here a little, there a little, and also to give me something to be able to share with you guys. You know, that's why there have been far less videos, and that's why I've been doing more of the, you know, more of the motivational Christian videos, which can be a good thing in itself, you know. The first flash vision or flash dream I will share with you was one where I was at a hotel room. And all of a sudden, at the back of the hotel room, there was like this window. And I went to this window and I looked out of it. And all of a sudden, the clouds rolled back. If you can imagine just seeing like a regular landscape, and all of a sudden you see clouds in front of your face. The clouds rolled back, like it says in the scriptures. But as it rolled back, it was like rolling back and showing me, as if it was showing me heaven behind, you know, the clouds. And what I saw was something I never saw before. I've seen my own man. I actually have a castle. The Lord has showed me that I have a castle, and it was gold castle, and it was so beautiful, brothers and sisters. It had towers on it. It's almost like a fairy tale, you know. It was just made of gold and had all these different carvings, and I don't even know how to describe it to you. There's nothing on this earth like the castle the Lord has made me. But this was strange. I was looking out the back of this window of this hotel room, and the clouds rolled back, and I saw part of heaven. And what I saw was this white, I'll call it a mansion. I don't know what it was. It was just really huge, looked like a building slash mansion. It was really big, and it was just white, all white. And I still, to this day, have no idea, you know, who that was for. I mean, do we have more than one? Or, you know, or was the Lord trying to show me something else? I'm not sure yet, you know. I just look at that, and I was like, I prefer my castle the Lord had shown me. You know, I really did. It was beautiful. It was huge. But, you know, I still don't know what it was. But I thought I'd share that with you. The second thing that I will share with you is this flash dream I had of a warrior chief. Now, this goes back to personal revelation. I've actually had a sister one time write me, and I shared it on another video I made, to where she saw me when I was talking about the 144,000. She had a vision of me as an Indian warrior chief with a headdress on. You know, what it all symbolized, being like a leader of, you know, of in time leader of bringing the, you know, of the 144, and of helping bring the tribes back to help lead the tribes back to Israel. I've then seen myself do things like part the seas over there. I've seen myself do a miracle in the air, like move back a sun or a planet or something that was in the sky. And I've the Lord has showed me leading back the children of Israel, you know, the lost 12 tribes. Lost 10 tribes. There are actually 12 tribes and only 10 are lost. But he's shown me helping lead them back to Israel. And, you know, it's the My Servant David character you'll find in scripture. I won't get into that teaching on this video, but it's the same character. It's the same character, but it's, you know, it's going to be, there are going to be a lot of mighty miracles done, brothers and sisters. I mean, the scripture teaches of this time period, to where such great miracles are going to be done, that the Bible says no longer will they say, you know, how great was the Lord when he had Moses and he took them out of Israel, you know, he parted the Red Sea and did all of this. The Bible says that no longer will they talk of this time period. No longer will they sing the song of Moses like what Moses did. We're about to come to a time period, the Bible says, that when the Lord brings the children of Israel out of all the nations and brings them back to Israel, that it'll be so great, there will be so many miracles done, this is the time period where Jesus says that that we will do greater miracles than even he had done. This is the time period that he's talking about. And it'll be so great that he's going to take not only of us out of Egypt next to Israel, but he's going to be taking brothers and sisters out of countries, out of the United States, out of Canada, Mexico, you know, like out of everywhere, out of every country probably on, you know, there's probably going to be people out of every single country on in this world. And the Bible says that no longer will we speak of what Moses did, but we're going to start singing songs of what, you know, what the Lord did from bringing us out of all the countries of the earth. So this is actually a time period that we're coming to. Just a vision I had. The dreams and visions are getting so, they're so vivid sometimes that you're not sure if you're seeing a vision or a dream or what. But I saw, again, I saw an Indian chief, full tribal headdress, representing the 12 tribes of Israel, representing a chief of it. And I saw the Indian chief pull back his bow and arrow, and he was about to let it go. Now, I know that I'm from the house of David, because the Lord told me, he said, Jacob, thou son of David. And I know that the Bible says that Ephraim is the arrow. Okay, now, I'm not sure if this is what I was seeing, but the Bible also says that Judah, the tribe I'm from, will be the fire, you know, and Ephraim will be the flame. And it says that Judah will be the bow, and it says that Ephraim will be the arrow. So I'm not sure if this is why I was seeing that, but I just wanted to fill you in on what that could mean. And I saw the tribal chief, and I saw him getting ready to let the arrow loose. So if you guys have any idea of what you think that might mean, please give me your comments below and share with me what you think that means. The next thing I want to share with you, I should have shared this in the last one because I think it might have been one of my, you know, all-nighters where they were trying to make me think I was out in space. But I was out in space, and there was this little section of highway in space that people were traveling, and they were calling it Hyperion's Loop. And I remember kind of being up and seeing high up in some kind of space travel thing, and they were talking about going through Hyperion's Loop. Oddly enough, you can research that and Google that and find a lot of stuff on Hyperion and all that, you know. It's just, but that, I will say this ahead of time, I think that might have been through one of the deceptive dreams I was having, but it just, it was kind of interesting, you know. Hyperion, you go through mythology and all that, and you can learn a little bit about that. I'm not telling you to do that, you know, I'm just kind of sharing that name because I thought that was really odd to have heard that. This week I also had a night to where I actually heard in a flash dream, I heard more like an audible, I heard B'nai Ha Elohim, which we know means sons of God. And this is during this week, you know, of a lot of the bad stuff that's been happening to me. I actually had a flash dream where I heard, you know, sometimes when I have flash dreams or flash visions, they're on their own. You know, I could be just in bed closing my eyes and all of a sudden I see a flash vision in front of my face. And or sometimes I won't see anything, I'll just hear something. And that's what I heard, B'nai Ha Elohim, sons of God. The next flash dream I had was one to where I saw a diamond ring, like a wedding ring. And then right after I saw that ring, the ring disappears, and then I see a price, and the price was $23,000. And I got a crack out of that because, you know, that's kind of like a little inside thing with me and the Lord, is the number 23. You know, I know that the number 23, when he's talking to me about it, represents the man-child. And so when I saw that wedding ring and I saw, you know, that the $23,000, it was not only talking about, you know, the bride of Christ, you know, being married to the Lord and getting taken up, but it was also a little inside joke to the man-child thing. And quickly, I'll say this, you know, just as with many scriptures, there's usually always a double meaning. And I want to state something here, you know, just as the woman... See, we watch different videos from different brothers and sisters, and, you know, we find bits of truth here and there, and sometimes scriptures are not always plainly meaning one thing. For example, the woman who has the man-child, you know, can represent Israel. She also can represent Mary, and as the brother from the Grox was showing on one of his videos, you know, the woman is also an angelic spirit, one angelic spirit who has a child. So to me, I went to the Lord, and I was talking to the Lord and pondering these things, and he pretty much showed me it was the same thing with the man child. Not only is the man child a group, like the female could represent Israel, and also represent one angelic spirit. The man child can represent, the bride of Christ being taken up, becoming rulers in heaven and all that. But there is also a spirit who is also represented in that too. There's an angelic spirit who represents the woman as well. And there's an angelic spirit that represents the child. And I've been shown that child is Raphael, who is promoted in the north to take that north throne spot, the old spot of the enemy. Before he fell, he led the armies of God in the north. And the man child is the angelic spirit that will kind of supplant him. As Jacob means supplanter, and the man child is Raphael, and will supplant the Lucifer in the north. And so, yes, it does represent group, but it also represents one angelic spirit. And also, symbolically too, I'd like to point out one thing, how the woman can also symbolize Mary. If you remember, at the cross, when Christ was crucified, he only had one apostle show up, and that was John. And what did Jesus say to John and Mary? He told Mary, Mother, looked at John the apostle and said, this is your son. And he told John the apostle, look, this is your mother, to Mary. So just as I know that Raphael was the apostle John, just as when Jesus was on that cross and he told Mary that to John, that's your mother, and then to Mary, that's your son, then it's also symbolic of, another multi-layer of the woman at the cross being, the woman having the man child being Mary and that child being John. The same way it's symbolically said at the cross of Christ in the scriptures. So these things are really multi-layered. It's not a one size fits all. Sometimes the Lord is so intelligent, brothers and sisters. You could have, if you wanted, he can have 10 different meetings to one scripture. You know how he does that. He's just so awesome. He'll find a way to make a scripture mean so many different things for so many different people. So when I saw that ring, marriage ring, and it had 23,000, I just, I could see a few different meanings in that. And then I knew he was making that also special for me, and special for all of us. It was just, it's one of those things. The next flash vision I had, I'm not sure if it was me or representing everybody. It was of an angel with wings. And, I didn't know if he was trying to show me Raphael, me, or if he was trying to show all of us. I'm not sure, but I saw an angel with wings, and I saw this angel holding on to a rope. And this rope, we know, every time you see or hear me talk about a rope, brothers and sisters, in a vision or a dream, 99% of the time it represents the word of God. Now, in this particular flash vision, the angel was holding on to the rope, and the rope was pulling the angel up into the sky. So this was kind of like the word of God, but also meaning the rapture, So it was kind of like, angel, you're about to be taken up. But it also could present not only me, because we're all going, all the bride of Christ is being taken up, the first fruits of Christ. So we're all about to go up, and it's just kind of one of those rapture flash dreams. Last night, I had one of the coolest experiences ever, and I'll share it with you guys. I was, worshiping, praising God. He had just got done giving me a few songs. Sometimes he'll do that. He'll give me some songs that I don't know, and when I listen to them, I'll find what they mean. And he sings me songs sometimes, and those are the most touching moments, But last night I was going through all that, and I got to a point where I was started to listen to the Bible audio for the Book of Enoch. And I got to about an hour and 44 minutes into it. Well, at first I started to listen to the Book of Enoch audio. And I started to remember, during listening to this, a vision I had a long time ago. I had a vision a long time ago. There was this house. The house was like a house of music and praise. And I didn't know much about it. All I know is I saw this house, and up in the air above this house was me and another angel. We made a perfect circle around the top of this house, and we were both flying around it. Now, if you can imagine looking down on a house and seeing up in the air two angels, kind of like Superman, one arm out, we're flying in a complete circle. I'm on one side, he's on one side, kind of like we're protecting this house. You know, we're flying around in a circle. And while this house of praise was all shaking and doing all this, we were saying something like, what did I say? Something like, nothing is impossible with God, or God can do all things. Nothing is impossible with God. We were saying something like that. You know, we were flying around in a perfect circle around this house. And that was pretty much the vision. And so last night, I started thinking about that. And right at 1 hour and 44 minutes into the book of, it's like the one done by the guy Charles, but 1 hour and 44 into it, it starts talking about a house. You know, a house where these angels were going around and all this. I'm like, whoa, like, it was reminding me, and totally the Lord was speaking to me. I just knew the Lord was speaking to me. And it was about that house, of that vision I had a long time ago. And when I started to realize he was talking to me, I looked at my phone because I wanted to know where I was at on that audio, you know, where I can go and find the PDF, the text for it. You know, I wanted to, you know, to know where that's at so I can write it down. And so I opened my, you know, the phone and looked at it, and it was at 144 into the, hour and 44 minutes into the Bible audio, or the Book of Enoch audio. For first, so that was like a confirmation in itself. It was at 144, you know, for the 144,000. And then that wasn't enough. I say, okay, what time is it? I look at my phone, brothers and sisters, and it was 2 hours. It was 2:32 in the morning, 2:32. Now, you guys know that 23 is my most seen number from the Lord. It represents not only the, pretty much for me, like he tells me, the Lord told me one time when I see 23, he's kind of relaying a message to me about the man child. And so when I see 232, that is like 23 forwards and backwards, just like a double 23, you know? And so I see that 144, and then I look at my time, and it's 232, and I'm like, whoa, oh my goodness, like a double, triple confirmation, you know? So I'm thinking about that house, and then I actually have that text in front of me now, and I'm going to kind of go over a few things with you that I found really interesting. Now, if you want to follow along, you can go to the 71st book in the Bible of Enoch. Now, first I'll start in the 70th book. It talks about going and talks about the Lord going to the north and to the west of the throne. It talks about like being with the two winds. Now, we know that there are four winds of heaven. The four winds are the four throne angels, like I've been talking to you guys about. There's the north throne angel, west throne angel, south throne angel, and east throne angel. Now, in the 70th books, it talks about the Lord. It talks about Enoch being taken up to the north and the west. Now, we know that on the west is where Raphael used to be, but he's not being promoted to the north. So this is kind of where Raphael would be, you know, and it talks about that. And then it goes into the 71st book. And there are some really interesting things on here I'm going to share with you. Now, it goes into this book, and it says in verse 5, "And he translated my spirit into the heaven of heavens." So it's talking about the highest part of heaven. "And he translated my spirit into the heaven of heavens. And I saw there, as it were, a structure built of crystals, and between those crystals, tongues of living fire." Verse 6. "And my spirit saw the girdle which girded that house of fire. And on its four sides were streams full of living fire, and they girt that house." Now, we know the four streams of living fire. This is talking about the four throne angels: Michael, Raphael, Gabriel, and, well, in this book, it's Phanuel. You know, some say Phanuel is Uriel, but anyway. So it's talking about this house, right? It's saying that they're seeing a structure built of crystals, and it's talking about this house, and it's saying this house is girded by the four angels, pretty much, brothers and sisters. Remember I just told you, he went to the north and the west. There's two of those right there. I'm seeing two of us on the top of that house flying in a circle, saying anything is possible with God. Now at 1:44 into this video, hour and 44 into it, at 2:32 in the morning, I'm seeing this about that house and about the angels that guard it. And in verse 7, it says, "And around about that house were seraphim, cherubim, and the ophanim. And these are they who sleep not and guard the throne of his glory. Remember I told you that the four throne angels, are they guard his throne. I've been telling you guys this is the first time the Lord has talked to me about this. And then it says 8. So saying here that those who guard that house, the one I was shown flying around, you know, being promoted from the west throne into the north, there's Book of Enoch saying that those are the ones who guard it. And it says, and I saw angels, and it also says there are other angels that go in and out of there. There are more angels that go in and out of there. And there's a lot of angels pretty much that go in and out of there. But then it talks in the next version, it says, and Michael and Raphael and Gabriel and Phanuel and the other holy angels and the holy angels who are above the heavens go in and out of that house. It's talking about that house some more. And Michael and Raphael and Gabriel and Phanuel and the holy angels who are above the heavens go in and out of that house. So if you were one of these other angels, then you would have been going in and out of that house as well. You probably wouldn't have been guarding the house unless you were Michael, Raphael, Gabriel, or Phanuel, but you were going in and out of that house receiving information from God, I would think, you know. And then 9 says, and they came forth from that house, and Michael and Gabriel, Raphael and Phanuel, and many holy angels without number. So there are a lot of angels that go in and out of that house. Let's see, let's read 2 more verses. In the verse 12, well, let's go to 10. 10 says, and with them the head of days, his head white and pure as wool, and his raiment indescribable, and that's white as wool, not texture, but it's talking about color, and his raiment indescribable, and I fell on my face, and my whole body became relaxed. And my spirit was transfigured, and I cried with a loud voice, with the spirit of power, and blessed and glorified and extolled. Verse 12 says, and these blessings which went forth out of my mouth were well-pleasing to before the head of days, and that he had of days with him Michael, Gabriel, Raphael, and Phanuel. And it says that thousands and 10,000 of angels without number. So this is pretty awesome, you know. So picture yourself in my shoes. So it's too, you know, I'm listening to Praising God and all that. Then I start listening to Bible audio. And I get to a part where I'm remembering the visions I had of a house where I'm flying, me and this other angels flying around a house, saying all is possible with God. And then I realized, I said, where is that at? It's 1:44 into it, hour and 44 minutes into it. The time is 2:32 in the morning, a 23 number I see. And then I get to it, and it's talking about pretty much that house is God's, unless I'm mistaken, isn't that God's house? It's talking about God's temple. It's talking about the structure in heaven where Michael and Raphael and Gabriel and Uriel are the four sides of that house, the four fires. And, you know, it's basically showing in that they were at, in chapter 70, that they were with two of the winds, and those two winds were the north and the west, and Raphael was the west going into the north. So I basically saw this vision many months, maybe a year or two ago, 2-3 years ago, I'm not sure, it was a long time ago, but I had that vision of that house, and I didn't even know that it was even in the Book of Enoch until late, you know, last night. So I just thought that was really interesting. There's so many, we all have our different, like, we're all receiving different types of things, you know. I think a lot of my stuff I'm getting is more like, you know, for the bride, more like angelic type stuff. And I know some of you are receiving, you know, we're all part of the body of Christ. We're all receiving different, you know, I may do this type thing and somebody else receiving prophecy on that, and somebody else is getting stuff on that. And, you know, I think mine's more towards, you know, the 12 tribes of Israel going back, and the armies of heaven, and just a lot of that type of stuff, you know. But we all have our roles. We all have our different assignments, and, you know, we're all bringing about different parts of Revelation, but we're all meeting at the same place, you know. We're living a really exciting time period, brothers and sisters, like none before. One thing the Lord does a lot for me, before I get to something I want to, a little study I want to go into with you guys, in Zechariah, you know, I'm having these experiences to where, you know, I'm getting really down, all the attacks and all that, and I'm like praying to God and all that, and we're actually at the time I'm feeling really down, and all of a sudden, he just gives me songs, you know, like I start hearing these songs in my mind, not a whole song. I start hearing like 2 or 3 words, and I'm like, what is that? But I know it's the Lord trying to tell me to go look up the words. And these are stuff that I, you know, things I don't know. And so I go to one, and he's, one is called You Are My Sunshine of My Life. These are two last night by Stevie Wonder. I go look it up, and he's saying, You're the Sunshine of My Life. And he says, that's why I'll always be around. This is when I'm like really down last night, you know, before all this stuff started happening. Then he goes, You are the apple of my eye. Isn't that what he says to Israel? You know, and this is the song he gives me right when I was feeling down before all this stuff started to happen. So you're the apple of my eye. You'll stay forever in my heart. And it says, I feel like this is the beginning, though I've loved you for a million years. Because he's loved us before we were even born. So as spirits, we don't know how long we were in heaven. We could have been up there a million years. Then it says at the bottom, you must have known that I was lonely because you came to my rescue. And I know that this must be heaven. How, then it's, I don't know. There's just so much cool stuff here. And the second song he gave me, if I have it up here. Yes, I do. The second song he gave me, I had to look up. I didn't know much about it. It was I'll Be There For You by Bon Jovi. And I think the song, he had me crying, you know. It was like, he says, I'll be there for you. These five words I swear to you. When you breathe, I want to be the air for you. I'll be there for you. I'd live and I'd die for you, which he already has. So it's so cool when he gives you a song that you don't know much about, and it's talking about I'd live and I'd die for you, because we know he's already done that. He goes, I'd steal the sun and the sky for you. Words can't say what love can do. I'll be there for you. And the last two things of this song that really caught my eye were, I'll be the water when you're thirsty. You know, we know that Jesus is the living water, that if we take of his water that he gives, we will never thirst again. And the last thing it says, when you get drunk, I'll be the wine. You know that God is the new wine, right? I mean, God, the Holy Spirit is the wine. Because when you drink, when you get drunk, I want to be the wine. So, I mean, you know, can imagine yourself going through all these, this week of attacks, and, you know, you get in there and all of a sudden you start hearing a song playing in your head that you don't even know what song, you know, you have to look it up to find out what it is. And you get to it and you start being lullabied by the Lord. You know, when I get stuff like this that I know is from him, I don't just turn on, you know, I don't keep turning, you know, to different, how to put it to you. When you give me a song, and the Lord gives me a song, I know it's from him, because I don't listen to anything but Christian music. I don't turn the TV on. I don't listen to different stations on the internet. I don't listen to anything but Christian music. And when I have a song that's not Christian music that's in my head, it's going to be something the Lord has given me, because I don't listen to nothing else but what the Lord gives me. You know, so it's really exciting. He gets there and he lullabies you. He is really like a bridegroom, you know, swooning his bride, making his bride completely in love with him. You know, I might have to make a part three to what I'm doing here, because I wanted to get into this last part, but I just realized that this is going to make it another long video if I do. So I might just kind of tell you what's on my heart or in my spirit for this video, and I might have to make a part three. I've never done that before, making a parts, but I'll have to do that, because I want to get into some things that would actually have went really well with this particular video, because it's more than the angelic stuff that the Lord has been talking to me about. See, he talks to me a lot about the thrones and you know, like rankings and like positioning of armies, and like, because he knows that's what I'll be doing in heaven. So he kind of, you know, when it comes to personal revelation, he kind of goes in that direction with me, you know, and it's really exciting for me, but it might not be for some of you who are not too excited about that stuff. But for me to be like Enoch, you know, and get to learn the mysteries of the angels in heaven, I just find that overly exciting. You know, it's really a cool thing to learn about. So yeah, I'll do a part three for that. So I'll just end this video, brothers and sisters, telling you that, you know, the Lord is coming. He loves you so very much. You know, when I'm getting attacked in this house, when I'm going through all this, they're at such a desperate level. You know, they're at a level, they're so desperate, because, and when they do that to me, I know that they know that their time is up with me. You know, it's like, we know that they have more time with those left behind, but to the bride of Christ who is getting taken out of here, they're giving their all to try to knock us off our course, you know. They're going to give it everything they have to stop us from going. And brothers and sisters, those of you who are still on the fence and trying to wonder if you should give your life to Christ, I plead with you and I beg you to understand that what I'm saying is true, that God lives. You know, I stood and talked to Jesus face to face, not just one time, but a few times. He showed himself to me in visions and dreams, probably 10, 15, 20, 30 times. I mean, I don't know. I'm not going to get there and count them all, you know what I mean? But so many times, he showed me a few times visuals of heaven, not in dream form, but as if I was truly there, to where I felt like I was teleported to heaven. I'm walking around, you know, this, well, I'm not going to say walking. I'll just say I'm looking all around me and I'm seeing the grass swing, and it was more real than what you'd see here walking outside of your house. So heaven is real. I've seen it, brothers and sisters. Heaven is real. And as I say that, my train's bumping or honking in the background. God is real. Heaven is real. The horns are about to blow, brothers and sisters. The angel is about to sound his horn, and the bride of Christ, the first fruits of Christ, is about to shoot up to heaven. If you have not already, please pray and ask Jesus into your life. Ask him to be your personal Lord and Savior. Invite him in. Repent of your sin. Say, Lord, I'm so sorry that I'm a sinner. Please forgive me, Lord God. Please forgive me. If you have certain sins that are bothering you, name them. Name them to him. Lord, I did that. I did that. Please forgive me, Lord. You know, and he will forgive you. He is faithful to forgive you. He wants to forgive you. He wants you to lay that sin at his feet, brothers and sisters. He loves you. He doesn't care about that sin. He wants to get rid of it. But in order for you to get rid of that sin, for him to get rid of it, you have to lay it at his feet. You just say, Lord, I'm a sinner. Here's my sin. Take it from me. And he will. He is faithful and just to do so. He will take that sin from you. But if you are believing false traditions of once saved, always saved, and are no need for repentance, or you know, or you can do whatever you want, long you say, Lord, I believe in you, and you're going to go to heaven, then but do what you want to do, willful sin, then you have another thing coming. You know, you're going to end up being left behind, and if you die in that moment, you're going to go to hell. He doesn't want that for you, though. He did not create hell for you. He created hell for the angels, the fallen angels. But when you choose to serve the Satan, when you choose, you can only choose one master. You know, you can either choose the Lord or you can choose the enemy. And when you choose the enemy, you have to go to the place prepared for the enemy and his people, his children. You know, but when you choose the Lord, then you go to the place prepared for the Lord's children. And he has prepared a place for all of you. All of you who are serving him and who are giving your life for him. Every time you do good things, you know, you're adding to your house or your place in heaven. You know, when you are not, when you're not, what happens? Is your house removed? I mean, does the production of the building of your house stop? I would guess it would. You know, from what I've heard from other brothers and sisters, you know, all I know is that he loves you so much. He loves you so much, brothers and sisters. You're hearing this from somebody who has never felt love in his whole life. I was a stepchild. I was dearly hated by my stepdad. I mean, he raised us from diapers, and he'd always tell us how much he hated us. I was mentally and physically abused as a child. You know, I can say other things and I won't. You know, I was just somebody who was uncared for in my whole life. I'd watch movies on the TV about a dad playing catch with his son, and I'd break down crying no matter where I was. So when I was somewhere, I would have to make sure I didn't watch stuff like that, you know, even because I'd break down. It was just something I always wanted. But I understand, you know, but now that experience of how bad it is without a father makes me understand even more how great the experience will be in heaven to have the greatest father of all. Because there is really one father. Yes, we have dads, but there is one father, and he's in heaven, and guess what? He loves you. Brothers and sisters, I stood in heaven one time, and Jesus was taking me into this to see the Father. And just like I've been telling you, I was in the back of Jesus. He uses this like a double thing, like he was showing me how much I was loved, but at the same time he was showing me that what I was getting in dreams and visions was true about Raphael. Until they got to promotion in the north, he was Raphael. Okay, the throne faces the west, so Raphael would be in the back until, you know, while he's in the west. And when I was walking, Jesus was walking me. Michael and I don't know who it was. I think it was Michael and Gabriel, or Michael and Uriel was on the right, the left of Jesus, and I was kind of like in the back. And we were just as we'd be standing at the throne as throne angels, we were escorting Jesus to the Father. And he looked at Michael and whoever it was, and he kind of poked him on the side as he would his child, and was like kind of saying he was proud of him, kind of thing, you know. And then he did the same thing to me. He turned around and he's telling me. But the part of this that was really touching is, I've experienced something I've never experienced before. All of a sudden, I go into this room, brothers and sisters, and it's white. It's so white, I can't see anything. I didn't see how the Father looked in his true form because it was just too bright. My eyes are hurting. And I get in that room, and all I hear is the Father's voice, and he tells me to go into the middle of the room. All he wanted to do, he said out loud, I can hear him saying this out loud, he wanted me to go in the middle of the room so that he could adore me. Adore me. You guys know how that feels for somebody who's been told they're hated and they're no good their whole life as a child? To be told by a father that they want to adore you? It means a lot. And for all of you out there who have had bad families and bad family environments, who haven't been loved or felt love, you have somebody up there who loves you, who adores you, who adores you more than you ever could know. And he wants nothing more for you to be up there with him so much that he gave his only begotten son who died for you so that you could be up there where he is. But you choose to serve evil. You choose to not have that when you choose to live in the world. When you choose to keep sinning, brothers and sisters, when you sin, you are cheating on Christ. You are his bride. But when you get there and you start to sin, if you sexual relations or doing bad things or this or whatever it may be, I'm not going to get into whatever sin it may be, but whenever you sin, you're blinking and giving the eye to Lucifer. You're blinking and cheating on Christ. He showed me this. He had me in vision, and he had me acting as Jesus, and he had me holding the bride. And he had me, and I loved this bride so much, I would do anything for her. But in this room, there was a man, an angel there, and it was Lucifer. And my bride, I loved her so much. But I noticed as I watched her that every now and then she would look at Lucifer and she'd flirt with him. And it broke my heart. It truly broke my heart. I thought to myself, if you love me, how could you keep flirting with Lucifer? If you truly love me, as you say you do, why are you giving your, you know, why are you cheating on me? Why are you also flirting with him? And the Lord showed me, brothers and sisters, that that's exactly what we do when we sin. That's exactly what happens when we commit sin and when we flirt with the enemy. We flirt with Lucifer. We say, yeah, Lord, we want to serve you. But in the meantime, we're going to flirt with Lucifer and, you know, watch the bad TV shows. And we're going to flirt with Lucifer and sin. And we're going to flirt with Lucifer and do this or that. Like, you know, we're saying, yeah, we love you, Lord, but we want to flirt with this guy a little bit too. And believe me, he showed me how it feels. It breaks his heart. He breaks his heart. He says, if you love me, how could you truly do this? He loves you, brothers and sisters, and I love you. And I hope that whoever is watching or hearing this at home, that I hope that you get on your knees and you say a prayer and you invite him into your life to be your personal Lord and Savior, that you repent of all your sins and that you ask him to tell you or to teach you and to show you what you need to do to find yourself worthy to make the rapture. And I pray, brothers and sisters, that you will let him in, to invite him into your life to be your personal Lord and Savior, and that you would stop flirting with the enemy, and that you, when you truly give him your life, that you will repent and stop doing those things with the enemy. Stop doing those things that make you sin. Stop doing those things that lead you down the wrong path, but that you be a faithful wife to the Lord, that you would stop sinning altogether. You know, I know that we all eventually sin, of course, but we are told to be perfect even as your Father in heaven is perfect, knowing that we will mess up eventually. But when we do mess up, you know, the Savior is there to forgive us if we will ask him and lay our sin at his feet. I love you. He loves you. And I pray that you do these things. And I say these things in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen.
Repentance, because you understand that you are a sinner, a wretched one, in both nature and deed, and that you deserve that which a holy and righteous God must give to those who sin, and that is his wrath and eternal punishment. That's repentance. Repentance is recognizing that. Repentance is self-abhorrency, as the confession says. Repentance is being so sick of yourself that you can't stand yourself and you want to get away from yourself because you recognize that everything in you is filthy and wretched and does not deserve to be in the presence of a holy God. And you turn from that and cry out to the only one who can make you any different. That's repentance. Repentance and faith. Faith in what? Faith in the Jesus of the Scriptures. Faith in the God-man. Faith in the one who was born of a virgin. Faith in the one who performed miracles. Faith in the one who died on a cross. Faith in the one who rose again on the third day. Faith in the one who's coming again to judge the living and the dead. Faith in the only one who's an answer to the sin problem from which you are in repentance. Faith in that one. Faith in him alone, in his completed work. Not his work and, but his work alone. That's faith. That's faith. Not just the name, but the person and work of Jesus Christ. When you grasp repentance like that, and when you grasp faith like that, then you understand the narrow road, the narrow gate, the hard road. Only then. If you think it's easy, and that you can continue to be who you are, and that somehow, because you say a few words, that makes you okay with God, if you think that because you are comparatively less wicked than the people around you, and that somehow that means you're worthy of heaven, if you think that because somehow you have not been as awful and as wicked as the Hitlers of the world and the Mansons of the world, and that somehow that means that God's going to grade on a curve, then you have not found the narrow gate. Repent. Place your faith in the Lord Jesus Christ. Cry out to him that he might save you and forgive you of your sins. Enter the narrow gate. Walk the hard road. The one with few companions. Because then and only then will you find life.
You've come in the final days.
All knowing God has held you in reserve
for nearly 6,000 years.
As well as your special.